Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Global Grand Masters Grand Finals, game number 2, Empire leading Vega 2-0, one win away from taking the whole best of 5 series. Of course, they did come in with that one game advantage, moving through the upper bracket. Game 1 that we just saw, pretty darn good on both sides. Big plays throughout the entire match, but Empire did manage to take it in the end. Comes Iori, joined again by Purge. Purge, how you feeling now seeing this first pick, Darkseer?
It means nothing to me. That's only one hero, man. I'm more excited about how good that last game was, and I hope we get a repeat of Empire versus Vega, because that first game was so back and forth. So many cool tactical decisions, laning, swaps, and overall movement around the map. It was cool to see. Really fun game.
Yep. Well, now we've got the old switcheroo. Empire going to be moving on to the dire side. Vega taking Radiant, and lo and behold, Rowl Ranger probably going to be played by Ramses once again.
It's a good opening. Broodmother's banned in the first round as well, so Empire was hoping that if they weren't going to grab the draw, that they would be able to. So, see what Vega does as a solution to it this time. Obviously, much harder with a Darkseer than it is with a Broodmother, since Drow Ranger's range can easily just kill those Ironshelled creeps. But I expect they'll still do a lane. You know what they could do is just an aggressive duel lane, maybe like Darkseer or Spirit, something like that could be.
Earth Spirit already very annoying, but you put an Ion Shell on him and there's all that extra damage plus the lane pressure from the Darkseer. I like that. You know that. What's wrong with the Earth Spirit recently? I feel like he's really been kind of forgotten about. We've seen him creep into a few drafts, you know, occasionally picked up early on if you don't want to reveal your hand. Why isn't he a first pick material support anymore? Is it just that Rolling Boulder nerf? Was that really what did it?
I don't really necessarily think so. I mean, it's been a couple things. He's got less movement speed now. Rolling Boulder definitely slows less. Maybe have to talk to top players. I would guess it's more just meta stuff than anything else. Just the heroes that you're playing against are often kill, or maybe Earth Spirit isn't as effective against them. And it's Draw Ranger as well. You know, if you're an Earth Spirit and you're against a Draw Ranger strat and you whiff your ultimate combo a little bit when you go in, then your hero's useless. And you just get silenced by draw, for example, you just die in the team fight.
Okay.
Things like that can be scary, so stuff like that.
Beastmaster, second choice for Empire, pairs very nicely with the Drow Ranger. Not the most creative of combos, certainly accustomed to seeing this, but Inner Beast mixing with the Drow Ranger, knocking down some towers. Whether the Beastmaster spends some time in lane or in the jungle, still a good choice. Have a hard lockdown set for a gust follow-up, get some damage coming in, even scouting with the Hawk. Have to battle with Drow is positioning, knowing where your enemies are, and Beastmaster makes that all the easier.
Great ganking against Juggernaut as well. Even if he spins, sometimes it can set up your follow-up kills. And yeah, I really like the opening from Empire here. Kind of covers everything, except for lane pressure if it's a jungle Beastmaster. So that's the only problem that they might. Stormspear banned by Vega, as is Venge, though the obvious trifecta of Beast, Venge, and Drow would be too much.
Yeah.
And we'll see where they continue their strat here. Luckily for Vega, they get to see more of Empire's draft before they pick in this round.
Yeah, still a couple of mid heroes they could think about. Batrider, another one that comes to mind, even if he's not mid. They could jungle the Beastmaster and put him off lane, though. Quite greedy that would be. Mid Batrider with a Drow is a lot more scary. But they take Oracle. Could have with a Drow also, yeah.
And good against Darkseer too. It's pretty decent against Jug in lane, potentially, because Fate's Edict can stop the spin damage. I think Oracle's a good pick. It's burst damage, right-click. Kind of does everything that Empire's draft does right now. They are starting to lack disable, though. It's the only thing Empire is probably going to be a little upset about if Vega picks like BKB carries kind of stuff could be problematic. Would be a good Slark game is banned, though.
Yeah.
As soon as I look up.
Yeah. Could also be a Juggernaut mid. Always something to keep in mind here. Pretty flexible for Vega if it's... Who usually plays the Juggernaut? Is it FN or no one, or is it one of these where they kind of switch it around depending on what the other hero is?
I think they're very willing to switch it up. I could definitely see Jug mid being a possibility. Or maybe even an aggressive trial lane, who knows. With Rubick Jug right now, it's looking like they could contest if they want to. And that way, at least Darkseer wouldn't be laned up against Drow Ranger and Oracle. That might be their option. I talked about a lot last game. The Brood worked fantastic. They had more late game problems that lost in the game, but I would love to see an aggro tri lane punish them. That would be pretty fun.
Yeah. Rubick, pretty good choice here also. Not really picked up for the null field so much, but some good setup with the telekinesis. Fade Bolt, some pretty good anti-push as well. Just a nice aggressive support that can help set up plays. Compare pretty nicely with the Juggernaut and hit Blade Fury early on. Set up rotations, find some of those kills. Some good natural synergy there. Also just a hero that Vega are very comfortable with. I know it's in one of their top picked supports if you look at more of their all-time history.
Yeah, Rubick's still a good hero. The aura definitely is one of the best aspects of him right now, but his other skills are still pretty useful. Pushing somebody out of position can be massive.
Yeah.
And his opponents don't really have the best disables at the moment. I mean, Rubick doesn't have the best things to steal either, is perhaps an issue.
Ooh.
But I think he's an okay hero here, though, for Empire. It makes their tri-lane actually pretty darn strong.
Yeah.
Someone that can initiate, basically be the frontliner for Draw Ranger, Oracle can do damage and back both of those guys up. I think it's going to be hard for Vega to do a tri-lane if they really want to do that.
Yeah, and it is a potential deny pick also. Vega probably looking for another support, and you mentioned that Earth Spirit Dark Seer combo could be something pretty potent. So instead, Empire take it for themselves, and they'll have a nice aggressive roamer that can put some pressure on and also just contribute to team fight. They were lacking on good magic damage in the mid game, and Earth Spirit definitely solves that issue.
Yeah, and you always need some kind of team fight when you go for a high ground push lineup, because if you're playing Drow Beastmaster, you're going to be hitting buildings, and what that does is it allows your opponents to eventually go on you. At some point, they have to. Vega's eventually going to defend the Rex, for example. So you need a hero that has team fight ability. That way, he can hopefully win you that team fight with the gold advantage that you've built up from the early towers. And Vega's going to also go for the same thing. They want to have team fight heroes. So Undyne's a great example of this. Drop the tomb and hopefully stay alive. With two melees on Empire, the tomb should be able to stay alive a decent amount.
You think so? I mean, Inner Beast, it's a small synergy, but it does give you that extra little bit against the tombstone.
It does. Yeah. They only have two ranged heroes, though, and they're both ones that should be defensive. Like, Oracle's going to sit in the back. Dry Ranger would obviously love to hit a building or hit a stone and kill it.
All kind of
comes down to where he places it, you know, if it's far away from Drow or Juggernaut's already on top of Drow, already on top of Oracle. It all depends on how the team fight's going. And then if they group up for Tombstone, it might allow Darkseer to do a vacuum wall on four heroes, which is easily worth the offset of losing a Tombstone. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things like that that Vega can potentially abuse positioning-wise in the team fight.
All right, we'll see how the Undying works out. I want Undying to be good. I remember when this hero, was it 3-4 patches ago maybe, when he was that first pick, first ban material before they changed the tombstone, and there were a few other things about him. I really like the idea of Undying. I always think of escape gaming. I know Sindarin likes him as well, and it feels like every time I see an Undying picked up, it backfires. Like, you have to dominate so hard. He's such a good team fighter, but he's just not good at closing out games. He doesn't really push high ground that well.
Can't farm at all, so he's behind. He just sucks. Yeah,
there's a lot of alternate realities where Undying ends up becoming a liability, and only a couple where you're like, wow, that Undying completely shut us down.
And that's boom or bust. It definitely is. It does give them potential to aggressive dueling, though. They could do Undying Darkseer, two melee heroes. Undying's very fast already, and with just Decay and right clicks and Iron Shell, he can be a huge threat. So I think that's what Vega's planning to do here, give Darkseer a bit more lane presence than normal. But again, they could aggro. Definitely could aggro. Jug, Rubick, Undying. I could see that being good. If somebody throw him back into a tombstone while Jug spins on them, that guy could definitely.
Yeah. That's true. Rubick Undying do have some kill power. Just rotating about, even, you know, Soul Rip, just DK spam is pretty good. Undying can hit pretty hard, especially in like the 1-6 levels when somebody's telekinesis. You can follow up, chase them down, get an Orb of Venom, all sorts of good stuff you can do there.
No, Vega's really missing a high ground hitter. Like, they have Jug Healing Ward right now, which is decent for them hitting buildings, but it's not the best. And usually you want two options for cores, especially when your other support's Undying and then you have a Darkseer. So Alk is a great choice here. They needed something that could give them more carry potential if Juggernaut got shut down. And Alk can also do nice things such as give Aghanim Scepters to all of his heroes. So
everyone. Yeah, I feel like I like this draft a lot more now, seeing the Alchemist. There is a lot of late game potential here. All of these Aghanim's upgrades are good. Even Juggernaut and Darkseers, they can be not the most useful ones at times, so they can also, but they add a lot of effect. Now Medusa, the final choice for Empire. Purge, we're going to take our fast break, and then we're going to get your thoughts about this final pick, Medusa.
Prepare for battle.
All right, folks, welcome back to the game. This is game two, officially, of Empire versus Vega in the finals. Of course, the one game advantage, again, that Empire did come into the series with, one game away from victory. Purge, we were talking about the draft. Last pick, Medusa. What do you think?
I think it's a pretty good option for what Vega's doing here. You know, if Tombstone gets dropped, for example, Medusa can ult, their whole team run towards the Tombstone, kill it, and then take a normal team fight. And not to mention just any of the melee heroes running at Empire, it's going to offset that. Did see the smoke here with their very fast lane ward. Doubt any of them will get caught, but
looks like it. Pretty good positioning so far. Vega on the hunt. Very good level one lineup here. Undying already picked up the decay. If you can hit a couple of heroes with that, it's really devastating at these level one brawls. But nice aggressive observer ward comes down. Let's give a little bit of intel into this mid lane, see when couriers rotate, if supports are venturing through or trying to babysit the mid. So probably a sign that Vega will drop some rotations towards that mid lane earlier rather than later.
And yeah, most likely it'll be Rubick in that area of the map. And it is Darkseer going to the safe lane, so some lane swaps here. It may be Empire getting confused, though. Right now they're sort of sending Beastmaster top. Be try versus offlane, try versus offlane.
So both teams are going to opt to aggro try, it seems like. Beastmaster did go Iron Talon level 1, so maybe he's just looking to jungle.
Safe lane Earth Spirit.
Yeah, that's
normal stuff. There's no camp locks here, except for the small pull camp here by Vega, so they will be able to pull offlane constantly. This should be quite good for them.
Now, Medusa versus Alchemist should be a farm fest. Neither side should have much in the way of kill scenarios unless rotations come out. Maybe early on, the harassment from the Medusa is annoying, can drain some mana, but Alk will be able to sustain through it over time and find some less hits. Can always work the jungle as well. A lot of options for the Alchemist that make some of that recovery farm. They are, in fact, doing a safe lane Earth Spirit, though, here, Purge. It's jungling Beastmaster. They're going to put Maposhka up here just to try and leech some experience and get some early levels.
It's worth it. If they get full experience and full farm gain out of Beastmaster, then they're gonna get overall more experience than their opponent. Kind of comes down to how the Darkseer link goes, but
okay, so they move Ramses up top now, and it's just an offlane Oracle. Equally weird, I think.
Yeah, they really didn't have a simple way to change this, but I mean, considering that there's free experience here, he'll probably ditch almost immediately now that these creep waves are being killed, but because he's obviously not gonna lane successfully as an offlane and have a good chance of killing him. Maybe not, though, because Soul's not that fast yet.
Yeah, I might be able to Venom, but leech up level 2 before he makes the rotation, but this is a sacked offlane type scenario.
Set up a TP instead on solo. That way he can go to other lanes if needed. Oracle's gonna have to ditch now, and lanes should be normal. Ramsey's in trouble top, though.
Yep, FN with the Blade Fury on. This could well be your first blood creep block, making his life a lot more difficult. King R and Maposhka looking for a return kill, and they will get it. Earth Spirit finding credit for the counter kill on Juggernaut, but obvious advantage for Vega. It is Rubick that draws the first blood and secures the bonus gold for himself.
Yeah, he's going to be happy with that. He gets level 3 out of this too, and this is going to allow Jug to go back to the safe lane if he so chooses. And then Darkseer could come top if they want to go full standard lanes here. Rubick's very close to Arcane's, is so big. Like, he's going to have way more mana output. Yeah. He can harass his opponents more, he can gank more often.
No one looking for that bounty rune up top. Gets denied by Maposhka. Actually, a very big deal. These early bounty runes make such a difference. The difference between no one getting a very fast armlet here and one that's just kind of mediocre. And that changes the tone of this overall early game. And plays like that will allow Empire to just farm evenly alongside of him. They do need to be cautious with this Drow Ranger, though. We've seen what happens when she falls behind. Ramses will rotate again back towards the bottom and find some farm, at least for now. It's going to be Drow versus Darkseer, one of the better heroes to deal with him. She's got nice range, can sit back and just kill the Ion Shell creeps, kind of like you were talking about. So I think finally Empire finding an okay place with these lanes. It'll be the two supports up top in the safe getting some experience now.
Yeah, I guess it's all right here. I think Vega's more happy with this because the Empire 2 supports aren't going to be able to grab farm here. Here's the pullback. Don't get a kill with that. Nope. Wasted tomb as well, but I mean, they have a better chance to kill either of these two supports. And yeah, Drow's going to farm fine versus Mag, but Mag's also going to get farmed. So it's like they're farming both lanes. They definitely have kill potential versus the two supports. And it should be offset, obviously, by Empire jungling. I think this is the better lane setup for Vega.
Yeah, hopefully they can find kills with these two. I mean, that is sort of the name of the game for Undying. He wants to fight sooner rather than later. Though it does have an okay window when he is pretty scary. Al keeping up in CS against the Medusa. It's an even spread. They're within one or two last hits of each other. 4-minute rune will come out. Will Undershock fish his wish and get the bounty? Absolutely. Wow, nicely played, Undershock. Great RNG right there. He's got weighted dice in his pockets.
Well, it's actually fine. I mean, if the bounty was top, he wouldn't be able to grab it, or Spirit would have snagged it.
That's true.
He was sitting there. Solo kind of wants to kill. Oh, he's actually in a lot of trouble now. He got the haste purged off.
Uh-oh. Afterlife comes in. He tries the TP home. Oh boy. Yep. Fortune's End drops a purge.
Yep, that's a mistake there.
Yeah, that hurts. Cocky haste
still,
rune.
Still spreading out mid a little bit. A little bit more experience. He'll have six. Just went Soul Ring Brown Boots. The standard elk build. He can just spam out acid sprays, prevent his opponents from taking his mid tower. Ideally pushing towards his opponent's one. So the time window here for Empire is basically Beastmaster will get six. He'll start moving around getting kills on supports or anyone else, and then once they have enough levels, they're going to group and start taking towers. And Vega's going to have to probably do split push. They can kind of defend using acid spray, fade bolt, stuff like that. But once they get dragon lances up on Drow and possibly Medusa, they're going to kill buildings regardless of creeps being there.
Yeah. I really like the Medusa last pick. I think it is a good mix of a hero that can obviously go late game and scale very nicely alongside the Drow Ranger, give them a two big core setup, and also a hero that can fight early. I think people still undergate the effectiveness of Stone Gaze in those early skirmishes and defending towers as well as pushing towers. The slow alone is pretty massive. 5 seconds of just a 35% AoE slow, you can get a lot of value out of that even if you don't get the petrifications.
And if you do petrify them, they take 50% more physical damage, which is of course amped by Beastmaster attack speed and draw aura, so you'll be able to kill people. Looks like Vega now rotating lanes, juggling safe lane.
Okay.
It makes sense, I think. He needs more experience. I like this gank, though.
Not something Ramses is expecting, I would imagine. Just brown boots, they'll surge him in. Rubik gets the lift, FN with the spin. Ramses trying to run the other way. He won't be able to outrange at the Ion Shell, tickling him down, as well as the Blade Fury, and it's an easy kill for the Jug. It's that one last slash, makes it 2-2. Both deaths on the enemy Drow Ranger, exactly what Vega's hoping for.
They did it perfect, and just like that last gank in the previous game. You know, they Iron Shell the Jug, he walks in, they surge the Rubik. There's no way that Drow can live then. The only way is if she would gust the Rubik as soon as the smoke breaks, but with Surge, it's so unlikely.
Yeah.
So, just a couple lane changes and it keeps getting them Drow kills. It really pays off in the long term.
Yeah, it's musical lanes all over the place. The one thing that's been static is Afterlife. He's been in the jungle, he hit level 6, and now comes the predictable smoke rotation. You know the timing window, but you don't know exactly when and where it's coming, which lane it will be. Rubik almost breaks the smoke. Darkseer farming away in the jungle. Will they find a target? Hawk comes out overhead. They find Sioma the Slayer. It's a 3-on-1, and Rubik will certainly fall here. Primal Roar gets deployed. Good measure. And Medusa helps get the kill with the snake. It's actually Beastmaster that'll get credit for the last hit. Nicely done, and it is a successful rotation out of the jungle from the BM.
It's a good gank for them. They get experience from that. That's the big thing. Rubik did pick up 70 gold with his Fade Bolt as he died, so he didn't actually lose that much out of that. Only Magic Wand, Brown Boots on him, so slightly underfarmed, but...
Yeah.
DD for Alchemist, not a terrible rune to have either, since he can just neutral a bit faster with that.
It
will just continue acid spraying.
Not out of control, though. You look at that net worth breakdown, it's pretty even. He's number one, but really you want your Alk to be moving ahead a bit more than that at this stage. Courier died in a very weird spot here in the mid lane. Right about here. I'm not sure what it was doing there. It has a Helm of Iron Will on it for no one. So the beginning of an armlet. That's pretty unfortunate. That is a pretty important farming tool for Alk. Gives him a lot of armor, some extra regen. He's not going to have it for 2.5 minutes.
Yeah, that is really weird. At least for with the DD here, he's going to kill these ancient or the large deck a little fast.
Yeah.
Gotta hurt a bit.
Yeah, Beastmaster keeping up with the Alchemist for the most part on net worth. That's how you know your Alchemist is not farming at maximum potential.
Jeez, that's actually incredible.
And now the safe lane for Empire is just free farm Haven. Ramses having a good old time. Vega's starting to rotate a little bit. Darkseer spending some time in the jungle. Their Undying, though, is struggling. Solo, he does finally hit level 4. He was 2 just a few minutes ago, so he spent some time in lane. He's got a very basic kit. Still no Oove, just movement speed items and a couple of consumables. So far, Solo hasn't really been able to achieve a whole lot.
He's actually accomplished pretty much nothing this game other than zoning some heroes, and that's not what you need to do with the hero. You need to force kills, you need to force fights, and make his skills useful, because late game, he's not going to be able to make up for that lack of farm with his skills. Yeah. Like, maybe he maxes out Tomb Soul Rip and he starts Soul Rip saving the Alchemist every 6 seconds. That's probably their plan here. That's one place where he could be useful, but they still have so much physical damage on Empire's side that I'm worried that it won't be enough survivability coming for his allies.
Second smoke from the Beastmaster, not going to be as successful as they had hoped, though it does get him into a crafty little spot in the trees. Hawk will fly overhead. This is Dire Vision we're looking at, by the way, and they see a whole lot. They're going to move into the tree line. Mag trying to get into the trees, but the Hawk shows them what they need, and they will just back out as TPs come in. Not going to be able to find this kill. Afterlife actually going in deeper for it. This is a very manly play, and it will not work out in his favor. It doesn't seem like Mag makes it out. He will get the False Promise, but definitely going to pop at the end of this one. Lots of damage from the Jug. Easy peasy for FN. They do get the tower, however, so you could call that death space created. Ramsey's happy at least to get the last hit on the tower.
I think that's okay for Vega. The tower is going to fall at some point anyways due to Drow. So the fact that they got a Beastmaster kill, the most farmed hero, or maybe one of the most farmed heroes on the enemy team, and got his experience really good. He's level 7, so that was a huge boon of experience for Rubick.
Yeah, and you know, Purge, this courier death actually hurts him. He would have the armlet right now. They're about to rotate in, and with an armlet, no one might have a chance to survive here. Magnetized does so much damage, but without the armlet, it is a guaranteed death. He buys out what little he can, but loses some unreliable there, and it's a great gank for Empire.
Yeah, and that was an Invis Rune gank, actually. Medusa had that. She scouted it out, and her spirit was able to initiate.
Yeah.
It only hurts Alchemist.
Oh, he's
probably
farmed.
Still dead, but yeah. Maybe not. You never know.
Yeah. Either way, Empire starting to feel like they're in a pretty good spot. 1,500 net worth, 2,000 experience. That is their favor. All of the ultimate secured, Undying, the lowest level in the game, still still lacking level 6, though. Often, case you don't see Flesh Golem come out at 6 anyhow. So I guess in his case, maybe not the biggest of deals. Still, the main point here, a little bit underleveled. Empire have just done a better job getting everything out of the jungle, getting farm up on their cores. They've just split the map a lot more efficiently.
Now, something else I just realized as well is another reason they picked Medusa was because she has split shots, very good against zombies. So, like Flat Cannon, it can actually attack each individual thing by itself. Cleave used to clear zombies, it doesn't anymore. Now you need split shot or flat cannon or something.
That sounds a little broken, because cleave is infinite. It'll hit everything like spiders, but the split shot at least has a finite amount that it'll clear out. That's nuts. Those little mechanics, man, make all the difference in the world.
Difference between plague wards being useful or serpent wards or all these other things.
Yep. Can you imagine if Crimson Guard blocked ward damage? My god, Afterlife down bottom, telekinesis, channeling up that unstable concoction. He'll drop the Primal Roar, no one, probably gonna stun himself here, he does. Afterlife might make it out, but Poshka with a great stun. There's the False Promise from King R. Afterlife goes to TP home, he will make it back to the well, and it looks like the heals there will keep him alive as he does end in the green. Very nicely done by Empire. They rotate just in time, and they keep their comrade alive.
And they got made out of it. It was basically Vega just wanted to save their skills. Bullet didn't drop Tombstone. He didn't think that they were going to need it. I didn't think they were going to need it, but the big Boulder Smash coming through stunning so many heroes made the difference.
Yep. He did actually drop the Tombstone at the end, but way too little too late.
That's one of those cases where you think that you're being conservative and it actually loses you a kill, and four of your heroes' time lost there for Vega, and Alk still isn't that far ahead this game.
Yeah, they have a long ways to go. But at that same token, Empire has a long ways to go also. There's always that threat of losing one mid-game fight. The Alchemist starts to jump ahead, and then all of a sudden, he's taken over the map. He's feeding Ags left and right, and breaking that high ground against a Darkseer with a Blink, Guardian Greaves, and Ags upgraded Vac Wall, that gets a little bit harder. Even just having that Tombstone on the high ground, a little bit harder to jump in, finish it off at the beginning of the fight. There are still a lot of options here for Vega, even though Empire seem like in great shape here at the 12-minute mark.
So Undyne does grab his ulti at 6. A better teamfight control there. And any damage amp is going to have. If he's in melee range, it's 20%. It's pretty huge.
Yeah, the slow also really comes in handy. Makes it easier for Jug, Alchemist, chase him down, get those right clicks in.
It's actually, it's an ultimate that is very undervalued, I would say. Oh, Meg might die bottom.
He's down. Yeah. Afterlife sets the whole thing up. King R with the purifying flames. Cures the kill. The boar slow makes it hard for him to get away without the surge, and they will get a follow-up tower. That's one thing that Empire's got going for him now. Objectives. They've taken all three tier one towers, haven't lost a single one of their own, so they are starting to control this map just more.
Yo, watch out, Rubik stole Precision Aura for all the range heroes on his team.
Yeah, this
is... It will give 10 damage to his range peeps when he activates it.
Still, one of the worst steals I think a Rubik could have, given that he has an entire melee squad alongside of him. If he had, you know, some ranged buddies, could be a good little gank and spell steal, perhaps, with the right clicks, but...
He's got no agility, it doesn't give
yeah,
much.
Yeah, I guess that's
it's
true,
so bad.
It doesn't really... Yeah.
Probably more like, wow, I got it, cool. I just feel like all of his steals this game have been so lackluster. I haven't seen him really get anything too good. If he can steal Medusa ulti or Roar, he's happy, but... Or maybe even Oracle.
Stealing a snake wouldn't be too bad either. Having that mana steal is actually pretty obnoxious.
Oh, Alk messed up. He just died to a neutral. He messed up his armor toggle or something.
Yeah, he just died to the Ancient. And he's at 3,200 gold, a lot of unreliable before the relic. No way that's intentional. We've seen a lot of people suicide for the free trip back to the well, but you don't do that when you have 600 gold away worth of unreliable from a relic. That is...
Yeah, and there's no way Alk would ever do that either. His levels are going to be so high that his respawn time is long.
True.
And turn on his ultimate, wait like 30 seconds, turn his ult back on, and get full HP. Well,
that makes it
so big.
Actually, it is. It makes it an easy Rosh for Empire here. It's going to be Medusa that gets the Aegis, and now it'll be a free tier 2 with Alk dead. Really no way they can defend it. Glyph not going to be used. I think it's the right idea for Vega, because Empire might just be going high ground right now. They've got a maxed out Drow Aura, 55 plus or 52 plus damage, two Dragon Lances.
They tombed mid? What the hell? They need to defend, and now the Radiance is delayed by like a minute and a half because he accidentally suicided.
Oh,
they just lost Rax, I think.
No. Vega, not like this. Undershock in the front lines. He still has the Stone Gaze and the Aegis. They'll start healing him back up. Oracle with the Fate's Edict, Purifying Flames combo. They've already gotten the tower down to about half health, and they did use the Glyph. Solo now goes into Flesh Golem form. No Tombstone for 30,
and he just
gets destroyed. Beastmaster getting credit for the kill. He does have a buyback, but he's not going to have a Tombstone anyway. He don't really have his ult, so I don't think it's money well spent. So it also won't cost him very much at this stage. Tier 3 tower falls.
They need Radiant so bad right now. The game is just over.
Oh, man.
They just didn't hit their window.
Wow. Add poor little Darkseer. This is one hell of a drought timing. They'll get the melee barracks down bottom. Range still standing, but Empire don't need to back up. Right now, Vega cannot do anything. Empire still have all of their ultimates available. Magnetize, Primal Roar, Stone Gaze. I mean, they're going to save the Aegis. They'll just back out. Still tier 2 towers remaining. They have, what, 3 minutes on the Aegis? Yeah, rinse and repeat, baby.
Oh, man. That's so bad for Vega. Those two mistakes, not using Tombstone. I mean, yeah, Tomb's a little bit iffy here in this case, but put it near the edge, get a sentry down to stop the Hawk. You can get some harass zombies out of it.
Yeah.
Delaying the Radiance by that just hurt everything. They could have taken a fight and tried something like surge in, vacuum three heroes, do a wall, and get some Radiance damage out of it. They just lost that opportunity as soon as they delayed the Radiance past that like double Dragonlance build on Empire.
And he still doesn't have the Radiance. It's a relic completed. He clears out an ancient stack. He'll be close. Still, Empire can probably siege this tier 2 before he even has the Radiance up. It will be available for the next high ground defense. Still a little bit of hope for Vega. A 10k net worth deficit. This is really brutal.
Your Elk has to be on top in terms of net worth. I don't know why he wasn't. I didn't watch the mid lane matchup too much, but perhaps Medusa denied the crap out of him. She's got 17 denies.
I don't think he got a single bounty rune, honestly. I think he got the first one, but he didn't get the 2 minute, didn't get the 4 minute, and I don't think he got the 6 minute. So that alone did slow him down a little.
True. That's pretty huge, actually. So props to the Earth Spirit for zoning it, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they really good rune control against this Alchemist. Now the high ground siege continues. Aegis still up, of course, and they've got about a minute 45 on it. So Undershock will be pretty eager to take some damage and maybe even get picked off. All right, this is it. The missed chance and the damage will make a big difference.
Oh, they let the ward die.
Stone gaze.
Just lost healing ward.
Oh, no. Still a lot of time on this Necronomicon unit. Maposhka jumps in. Could be a big magnetize here. Comes out on three. Solo tries to hop forward, but that won't happen. Undershock still with some time on the Aegis, standing his ground. Split shot, laying in some damage. Stun from no one, just not going to be enough. False Promise trying to keep Undershock alive. Stolen Primal Roar does help. No one in the front line starting to bring him low. Ramses could die, but they don't have the damage to finish off the kills. A lot of low health heroes on the side of Empire. Vega did lose two, but they're holding the barracks. I think this is more than they would have hoped. Four Undershock stunned up. They bring him into the wall. That's the end of the Aegis. But now Dusa comes back full health, full mana. She's one scary beast.
Can't really fight until they get Chemical Rage in 12, so I think the Rax falls here. No two good. Melee Rax at 18 minutes. Bad sign versus drop.
Yeah, absolutely. Now Seoma the Slayer gets silenced as he pops forward. They'll bring him down. Can't punish the Earth Spirit. He still rolls out despite the stun. Now silence on two from Ramses. Solo gets surged back. He'll live, but now no one. Caught by the stun as Maposhka reinitiates this Blink Dagger, doing so much work. The Alk does have a buyback after these hero kills. Mag getting low. Now Omni Slash does net a kill on the Earth Spirit. That's something for FN, but it's not much.
Oh, this Medusa pick just changed so much in this game. Gave them the counter to Undying. Gave them the tanky frontliner so it doesn't have to be Drow that gets hit. They could heal her from the backline and back her up with Beastmaster Aura and Drow Aura so that she actually does real damage despite only having like two items.
Yeah.
Just easily 2-racks their opponents due to slow farm and some small mistakes.
15k net worth lead here at the 18 minute mark. The Aegis might be gone, but Undershock is one scary devil. I absolutely love this build he's gone for in the mid lane. It's really what Mushi likes to do, one of the recent players to really popularize this build, but the movement speed with the phase boots, Yasha, Dragon Lance for the stats, and then right into Scotty. Can be a hard build up, but he's got the Orb of Venom, and now he's got some pretty nice stats to go along with it.
Much better than going for Mantis style. He doesn't need his illusions to do extra split shot damage. He already has plenty from Drow, so he just absolutely needs to just be tanky, and Scotty's by far the best item for that.
Yeah, absolutely. One tier 2 tower remaining here for Vega. It's in the top lane. We'll keep that lane of barracks safe. Empire, they really don't seem to be in a hurry right now, and simply because they don't need to be. They've got great late game. They know the Alchemist is down. They can easily take the next 5 minutes to farm up their next round of core items. They've even got a Vlad's out on the Beastmaster. Decides to skip the Blink Dagger. I like the idea to just get a team fighting item. Amp up the damage of the whole team, and the Scotty's done already. I thought she was still another ultimate orb away. It was all on the courier the whole time.
When you get a double racks like that, you get so much gold advantage. Cool. It just helps them a lot.
Wow.
I feel like the supports on Vega just weren't the right pick here. Like, Rubick has felt useless all game. Like, he had Fade Bolt to slow pushes and offset some of the Drow Aura, but it did nothing here. He hasn't been able to steal very many good ultimates. He got Beastmaster Roar in the last fight, but like the only good spell I've seen him take all game. Everything else has just been trash, like Split Shot, Boulder Smash with no ability to drop stones on the ground.
Yep.
Same Final case hold. For the Undying too.
Could be inbound, no one, very low on HP right now. He's picked up a Blink Dagger, actually gonna channel a stun. This is a bit risky. He pops the Chemical Range, he will start to regen up. Empire are just gonna slow roll it. They'll siege from the low ground. They finish off the tier 3 already. Magnog is primal. Rorty's down. Undershock with a well-timed ultimate. Gets a petrification onto Solo. Two dead. Buyback on one. But Solo will be out of the game for 30 seconds. Stolen primal roar on Undershock. Burns some of his mana. But doesn't set up for a kill, and that's gonna be it. No one drops his Radiance. Feeling demoralized. As their barracks get killed and GG is called. This may be the fastest best of 5 series I've ever cast.
Yeah, this was pretty underwhelming for what we expected out of the finals. Game 1 was so good too, but Game 2 they just got barely outdrafted. The timing window for Empire just hit, and the game ended. They didn't have Radiance in time. Undying had gotten nothing out of the map. He deserves his 0.1 fantasy points. There's just almost nothing Undying could do this game, unless